heard they crowded the floor. Couldn't bear it without you. Don't get around much anymore.
Welcome to Curators in Quarantine, where museum professionals, art historians, archaeologists, and really anyone interested in art and archaeology get together and share their work in this strange time of pandemic. I'm Jeffrey Spier, curator of antiquities at the J. Paul Getty Museum in Los Angeles. And today we have a very special episode. We are celebrating our favorite holiday, Squirrel Appreciation Day, which is January 21st. I'm very fortunate to be able to be joined by three colleagues from the Getty, all of whom have special knowledge about squirrels, both contemporary and historical. There's a lot of squirrel expertise at the Getty, it seems. Keishia Gu is head of education at the Getty. Beth Morrison is curator of manuscripts, and Anne Woollett is curator of paintings. Keishia, you and I have both found a degree of solace during this pandemic with squirrel friends, or at least acquaintances. So tell me about yours.
I honestly, and I credit the Getty for it, because I was literally on a Getty call right when the pandemic hit, and the squirrels just were so brave. They just became so brave. And you know, we go to work and we go to our offices, so we're not paying attention to what's in our yard. I don't. You know, I get in my car and I drive away. But all of a sudden, you know, you're sitting in your yard or on your porch and you notice. And just all of a sudden, I just noticed. I was like, oh, they're here.
Yeah, it's right. And you hear birds and you hear, see all sorts of things. And it's nice to be able to have some connection somewhere.
It was nice to stop and even be on a work call. And that's what started it for me. It was, I was talking to somebody from the Getty and a squirrel just came down off my fence. And now I'm a squirrel mother. I'm mother of squirrels. That's what my husband said.
That's right. And you've prepared something for us. I love this. I was not expecting this. I think it's really great. We're going to run Keishia's squirrel, what do we call this, experience?
It's like it's a walk down memory lane. It's how far I've come on my squirrel family journey.
Okay, let's do it.
There we go.
Oh. Very good.
Oh.
This is the moment. Like, this is literally the moment.
Is it the first time? Oh.
This was real time. Like, I happened to take out my phone and capture. This is so cheap.
Oh.
And she kept coming back. And so then my daughter got in on the act. That's my daughter, Aria.
Aria, and I love the pose with the squirrel, Aria.
Oh, we knew it was Sochi because Sochi had like some missing fur on the right. So we were able to know it was Sochi, but then Sochi never came back, but she had kids. So we kept her kids. So we had Maurice, Chester, and Chassie.
Generations of your squirrel already. How long the pandemic is going.
This is how long it's been going.
Oh.
And then they started coming to the door.
Oh boy.
And I have two big dogs and they just didn't care. They just like, they would come to the stairs. They would come to the windows, they'd be on the roof, so.
Oh man.
You can just tell like, over the course of the pandemic, they just kept getting closer and I kept getting closer and closer.
Do they let you pet them?
They do.
Oh.
They're so gentle. Wow.
They're so sweet.
Right.
So we love it.
Oh.
That's
that
our video.
That is great.
Keishia, how did you come up with the names?
I don't know. Honestly, it was... Like, Sochi just came up because I was telling Jeffrey, my daughter was having a hard time pronouncing squirrel. Like, she couldn't get Squirrel. So she was just like, sis. And I was like, Sochi. And more recent, Chester, I don't know where I came up with that. Chassie, I posted something on social media and I said, what should I name this one? And people were like, name her Cashew. And I was like, no, that's too obvious. So Chassie.
No, I gave my squirrel a, and I'll show you mine because it's similar. We have this similar connection. It's just nice to sit outside with your squirrel. I read to her. I named mine Belka, which is Russian for squirrel, which is not really that great a name. Like, as I said, it's like naming your dog. But
I have the connection because Sochi is Russian. So
Sochi's Russian. It's just, but I sit on my patio and then she sees me and comes down.
They climb so amazing and jump.
Oh, look.
And what I like is she'll sit with me for a long time, you know, and I'll read to her and maybe she wants more nuts, but I like to think she listens to the reading.
What language does she prefer? Ancient Greek?
I showed it on one of my previous episodes. I was reading Pliny, had a Latin copy of Pliny, and she came right by and sat by it. So
yeah.
I mean, I think that's clear evidence that she's interested in Latin.
Yes. Well, she singled you out.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah. Anyway, go back to you, Keishia. I'm sorry.
Tell me,
though. I mean, we do like to ask people how they're doing in this time. I mean, you seem to be, you know, your daughter, and it's nice. Mm-hmm. How about at the Getty? You know, used to be a head of education where we would bring an enormous program of school children. We would bring them to the Getty to visit. And that, of course, is suspended for the time being. So what have you been up to these days?
Absolutely. Yeah, you are so right. Enormous. We have one of the biggest field trip programs. We would bring about 150,000 to 160,000 kids a year.
Yeah. It's one of the greatest things. I go in the morning. The galleries are full of kids every morning. It's great. Yeah.
It's amazing, like the chatter of kids. So, but, you know, it was really important for us not to lose that. And to know that there are so many kids, you know, in Los Angeles and around the country who are suffering, who don't have access to, you know, the technology that they need. They don't have access to the arts. They're sitting at home. And so we, on a dime, flipped our field trip program. And so it's completely virtual. You know, we are not going to see nearly as many numbers as we normally see. But virtually, at this point, we've seen about 10,000.
I was going to ask how many you reach. It's a lot. Yes.
It's significant. You know, our gallery educators spend about 5 to 6 hours a day with kids. And you know, the nice thing is that it's not even just kids in Los Angeles. You know, at this point, you know, it's Ireland, it's Mexico, it's Seattle, it's Pittsburgh. So it's
this is great. This is one of the great things that will come. There will be some good coming out of all of this, and that is
absolutely.
Bigger international reach.
Yeah. But that's been really amazing for our docents. You know, we have 600 docents that, you know, we also train to help support us.
These are all volunteers. Yeah.
They're all of our volunteers that have, you know, wanted to stay connected as well. Like, this is a community for them too. So for them to be able to continue to participate and volunteer for the Getty, even if it's virtual, like, that's been awesome for them. Last night had a really good time talking about some pieces at the villa. I should have invited you.
I never get invited to
this. I'm sorry. So we also started doing it for adults. We were having such a good time with the kids that we started getting get together. So on Fridays and Saturdays, our educators, you know, hop online. We had some conservatives there last night. It was super fun. Super fun.
That sounds great. That's great. Thanks for all that. It's good to see that these sort of programs are going on. It's such a struggle now but we're still reaching a lot of people, I think. A lot of squirrel enthusiasts, I find. And, you know, I was thinking about this and about the squirrel issue here, and it's clear that these connections, you know, our connection to the animal world and squirrels in particular is nothing new, of course. And I thought Beth is an expert in this. She has worked on animals in medieval art extensively. I can't think of a more knowledgeable person. So Beth, you've put together some ideas for us too, yeah?
Yes, I got some great medieval images to share of squirrels.
Let me go to those.
So I'm starting sadly with the fact that squirrels in the Middle Ages were a commodity. And so here we see hunting squirrels because, of course, fur, especially in Northern Europe, was such an important part of life, keeping people warm. And so fur pelts were a great trade commodity. Squirrels Melka, were all
don't,
over.
Don't look at this, Melka. Stay.
Yes. No. This is Northern Europe in the Middle Ages.
Yeah,
they're pretty far in time and geography. And in fact, Keishia, you were talking about the fact that you have two large dogs. I also have two large dogs, but the squirrels are afraid of them. So unfortunately, we don't get much, but I get a lot of on the walk, squirrel. So I think that they would be very good hunting partners if I were hunting squirrels. But of course, the squirrels in our neighborhood are very safe as well. They don't get hunted as they did in the Middle Ages.
They're fast.
But when I was preparing for this, I actually found a whole website about squirrels in the Middle Ages. And I've put the web address down below in case people want to freeze this and enter it into their thing. So a lot of these images can be found on that. So there are academics who, Jeffrey, are much more squirrel experts than I in the Middle Ages. So, so let's move hunting behind and move on to happier ideas. So squirrels, just like today, were a great source of entertainment and people always think they're cute no matter what time period they're in. So they appear a lot in medieval, what we call marginalia, which is literally Latin for things in the margin. Very, very fancy Latin word. But here we can see marginalia featuring this little squirrel. And like Keisha's squirrel, he's still got a nut. I don't think it's a cashew. It's nothing that fancy.
But I've never seen squirrels hold them in one hand. That's a great pose, I think.
As you know, as you can see on this page, hopefully the caterpillars in your neighborhood are not that large compared to squirrels. So there is some fudging in medieval illumination. But what I liked about this is actually an image in the Getty's collection from our famous Spinola hours. And what I love about this is that it gives you the sense that these 16th century illuminators really wanted to make it, even though it's out of proportion and maybe squirrels don't really hold one nut in one hand, it's this idea that these are actually objects that are laid on the page. And you can see that because there's little shadows underneath all of the worms and the thistles. But interesting, the squirrel himself does not cast a shadow. So he's sort of separate and distinct. So he's interesting in that way. But if we move to the next one, there's an even more entertaining. This one, I know it's a little hard to see. This is an image in the British Library, but it's fun because this is real, what we call fun marginalia, because it's a monkey on the back of a unicorn fighting a squirrel who's mounted on a goat.
Oh my gosh.
You don't see that a lot.
That's pretty,
This sort of topsy-turvy world of animals that you see in medieval illuminations. And why I like this one in particular is I put a picture of the text on here too, because this is actually a text called the Livre du Trésor, which was a very early sort of natural history encyclopedia that actually talked about the natural world and the animals in it. And so it's sort of a scientific text that then in the imagery is really giving you this a very imaginative feel. But I think that squirrels, like monkeys, are very mischievous. So I like the fact that they're kind of fighting each other. So that's really quite fun.
Very bold. That's what I think about when I think about my squirrels. Like the no fear.
And fighting with the spear. Yes, of course.
They'll probably start riding your dogs.
I mean, I'm telling you.
One dog and the squirrel on the other, and they can tussle.
The fact that I have a Rottweiler and those squirrels come to the door and they just don't care.
They just laugh at it.
Yeah. And what do they do, Keisha? Did the dogs try to get to the squirrels?
No, they actually are very, they've been trained that they don't go after them. They don't do it. They are, these squirrels are a part of our family. They are pets.
That's nice. All right. And then we move into the realm of pets. So this is a 14th century illumination from Oxford. And this reminds me very much of your pictures of you, Keisha. I don't know if you have an outfit like that you could, you know. And see, she's got braids. You could kind of do the Princess Leia thing, you know. You know, we were talking about those Getty reenactments. I think this would be an awesome one for you.
Oh my gosh. You're right. Like for the Getty Art Challenge?
Exactly. So in any case, this is the pet squirrel of the woman. And the reason I put the sort of enlargement here is because you can see the squirrel's actually got a collar with a little bell on it. And oftentimes in the Middle Ages, you see these silver collars with bells on them. That was apparently what they did for these domesticated squirrels. And again, I show you the text page because this is actually a medieval prayer book that was probably owned by a woman. And so who knows, this could be a portrait of the woman and her actual pet squirrel that she's reminded of in her own prayer book. So I like that kind of evocative. I know if I had a prayer book, I'd definitely put my dogs in. So this is my imagination.
This shows you how connected we are to this time. It's the same. Keisha's the same. She could be on that page.
Exactly. Right. If you had a prayer book, you'd put in Maurice and, you know.
And Chester, Cassie, absolutely. Now I have a question, Beth, like were the bells just specifically for squirrels or was it all pets?
Yeah, interestingly enough, as far as I've seen, and maybe Anne will have something to say about this later as well, but in the medieval illuminations, it's always the squirrels that have bells. I don't know about you, but my dogs are loud enough. They don't need any, entrance that they're there. But I think squirrels, because they're smaller and they're more quiet, okay. They want to know where they were, or it might've been an adornment thing. I was telling Jeffrey that I went to the world's only dog collar museum, which is in an English castle. I don't know if any of you guys have ever been there. I forget which English castle it's at, but it has a maze and they have jousting. And they have a dog collar museum where they actually have medieval collars from dogs, which is pretty amazing. And none of them have bells. So it really did seem to be something that was associated with squirrels.
And we have another. Well, let's show your other one you have.
Yeah. So this is a much later one where you can really see the detail on the squirrel. I love this one. You can even see the little like claws on the squirrel on her hand and on her dress. And you're thinking, that looks like an awfully fragile fabric for squirrel claws. That was my thought. Like you can see the threads that the little squirrel, and again, the squirrel looks like it's holding something up, but you can see this collar composed of little tiny silver bells, and then this beautiful silver chain that's acting like a leash. And you can see that there's actually like a loop on the other end of the chain. And I think somehow they would like attach it to their bracelets or something else so that the squirrel wouldn't, you know, fly away. But this is a very special squirrel because you can see the long ears and the really fluffy tail. So there were a number of different squirrels that you could domesticate. And it's interesting, I don't know anyone. I mean, obviously Jeffrey and Keisha have pet squirrels, but they don't like live inside.
It's anything. A friend of mine. She's not my squirrels.
Right. They're just, they're squirrels who've made friends with you. But it's interesting that they were such a popular pet in those days, and they don't really seem to be a popular pet anymore. I don't know, Anne, maybe you can take it from here and give us a sense more.
Yes, we're sort of now into Anne's area of 17th century painting.
The 16th century portrait of a woman by an Italian master. And this really was her individual pet squirrel that she clearly chose to have represented in her portrait because of its importance in her life. Oh, and one more thing I wanted to say is I drew up some names of squirrels, some pet names from the Middle Ages. And I found one of my favorites is Smile Fest was a name that you would give pets in the Middle Ages.
Oh my God.
Nose wise, amiable, nameless for people like Jeffrey who are a little at loss for what to call their pets, and hold fast, which I really like. So
I like that one.
Names for me for future, maybe for my dogs.
Okay, all right.
You know what I love about this too, Beth? Thank you for sharing all that. Like, I'm going to show this to my mother-in-law, who gives me so much smack about having squirrels around. And to my
not everyone is a squirrel enthusiast, I know.
A proud historical tradition.
Exactly. I'm going to be like, listen, I could have been one of these ladies in these portraits. Like, give me some credit.
That's right. So, Anne, now that we're in this sort of milieu, you know quite a lot about this too.
Well, I have a squirrel friend, but it's an historic squirrel. In the next slide, Jeffrey. This is a very
great pictures in the world.
Yeah, this is a famous painting by Hans Holbein the Younger, and it's in the National Gallery, London. And I mean, I've known the painting for a long time. I've always loved it. I think it's incredibly beautifully painted. But we are organizing with the Morgan Library an exhibition for this coming fall on Hans Holbein's portraiture, and in particular, how he worked with his patrons to create very specific images that elaborate on who they were and what their aspirations were. This is a Tudor lady. And one of the interesting reasons we might know who she is because of the squirrel. So so often female sitters are their identities don't come down to us over time. But this portrait seems to also be a kind of heraldic statement. So one of the interesting things is this lady, probably Anne Lovell, born Anne Ashby, had this pet squirrel, and it was not part of Holbein's original plan. He painted her with a very nice bodice on her gown and a belt and things. And then it seems that he and the sitter and maybe her husband also wanted to have the squirrel added. And so it's like the last.
You forgot the squirrel. Hans forgot the squirrel.
Don't forget the squirrel. And so apparently, though, this family, the Lovell family, the squirrel is part of their coat of arms. So the three squirrels on there. They're from Norfolk, so kind of eastern part of England, where there were big forests, coniferous and also oak forests. And so it was full of squirrels. And I love the squirrel. It's a red squirrel. And I think Holbein really loved painting it because it's got all of these great details. And that little dot of white you see is actually the squirrel's stomach, a little belly of squirrel. As in Beth's example, Anne Lovell seems to be holding the squirrel by a chain, but there's no bell that I've been able to discover. So this squirrel was able to kind of leap around probably in quietness. You know, it's such an interesting idea to add a squirrel because, of course, they're so dynamic. Like, I think all of your examples, Beth, kind of show squirrels, you know, out in the world being squirrels. But Holbein, like, captures this moment, a still squirrel, before it bounces off into the ether again.
And I love how fat he is. I mean, that is a pet squirrel if I ever saw one, because he's like chubby.
Yeah, and he's kind of muscular, and he's got that, like, you know, those like strong legs, and a bit like your lady, your Italian lady, his paws right on this soft kind of black velvet, and so you get this great kind of feeling that it's a heavy squirrel, or, you know, but yeah, so, you know, in a strange way, it's kind of a statement about Anne Lovell and who she is, and the fact that she had this companion, probably, but also kind of doubles as a family statement.
Yeah. I love the stillness of this. It's so still, and you're so right, Anne, in terms of like capturing that moment before the squirrel like hops off somewhere, like the juxtaposition of like squirrel life and what squirrels actually are like versus like this.
Yeah.
And to see her face, her solemn stillness, and to see the squirrel, like it's a little unreal.
It's a little moment of peace. We have a few seconds before.
And it's a, you know, it's kind of reverting from where Beth was, an interior, you know, portrait, to this is kind of Holbein's way of kind of alluding to nature, but it's, you know, a very kind of designed, you know, vine that's behind her, and then this incredible blue, which, you know, kind of alludes to the sky and to, you know, the outdoors, but it's not a specific place. It's all kind of an artful backdrop to her, so. Yeah.
And Anne, in the analysis of the painting, because you said the squirrel was added, was the bird and the vines also added? Was it a very static portrait just with the blue originally, or do we know?
My feeling is, because Holbein loved this fig vine, that was part of the original plan, and it has some underdrawing. It looks to me like the starling was added also late over the vine. And the starling, those could be pets too. But it also, if you say it in a way that relates to the location, it's very similar to the name of the village that their estate was in, East Harling. So it's thought potentially it's kind of a playful way of alluding to where they're from. I just love the way the bird is like right by your ear.
Yeah.
Like, but I don't know, Jeffrey, if we have one more.
This wonderful.
Squirrels that are still. So this is by another German artist, a couple decades after Holbein. Holbein was like 1528, 27, 28. this is Hans Hoffman in the National Gallery of Washington, and he was someone who paid a lot of attention to what Albrecht Dürer, one of Holbein's contemporaries, was doing with representing animal live animals alone on a sheet of vellum. I particularly love this one. This is Hoffman's own treatment of this one squirrel that's eating, and I think that he really enjoyed like the muscular toes and fingers.
I'm very familiar with this image. This is what Belka looks like sitting on the chair.
Yeah.
She's got those strong feet.
Strong feet and soft for like, I'm sorry, I didn't give you a detail of this, but it's just incredible. You know, Hoffman used these single hairbrushes, it seems like, mm-hmm. kind of create these individual strands and like the kind of thicker hair in some places and then the kind of stiff whiskers.
Is this tempera, Anne? It's not pastel, right? It's too early.
Right.
But it has a pastel feel to it, doesn't it?
Yeah. It's like gouache, it's like layers. And I think there's like pen in there sometimes too. So you give this kind of variety of texture. And the little white, I love the white tummy again. And then there's sort of white on the muzzle.
Little white.
It's really great.
That's so amazing.
But again, yeah, this idea of like showing this active animal very still, I think is fascinating so that you can really appreciate it. It's sort of a new idea at this time at any rate, you know, pre-photography.
I won't embarrass myself on this call, but I have been sketching some squirrels.
Oh, wow, really? Like,
it's been really interesting because, you know, I'm trying to appeal to my daughter who's like, draw me a squirrel. So I literally, my artwork has like started to evolve into now I just sit and I'm just like drawing squirrels like every other day.
You should have brought it along, Keishia. Next time we'll add that.
Next time, part two. My squirrel cartoons.
Okay.
Well, how are you doing that? How are you kind of capturing the moment of the squirrel?
I'm a really good cartoonist. Not very good at, like, I can't do this, but it's reminding me of like what I've been doing for my kid in terms of like turning those squirrels into like little figures, like little action figures.
Yeah.
So that's it. I'm just making cartoons.
That's great. It's been fun.
If you look at like my sketchbook over the years and like now all of a sudden in this time, like now all of a sudden, like there are pages and pages of squirrel cartoons. Like it's another nod to the pandemic and how it's shifted my life.
Excellent. So then maybe that's what Hans Hoffman was doing here. It's like, Daddy, draw me a squirrel.
Right.
So. I was wondering, do we have any information yet about whether Hans Hoffman had pets?
we don't, but you know, he did a lot of these animals. You know, we have a painting at the Getty of the bunny, the hare in the forest. So he did other hare portraits, if you will, on vellum too. So he just was really interested in animals and the natural world and kind of managed to combine both like the things that he saw with an idea of sort of how they should look at as an artistic subject. So it's super interesting actually. And he's really the first one to, I think, who gives narrative. So like this isn't obviously a squirrel that's eating, and that's also kind of interesting and new. The idea that they're not, it's not a dead squirrel that he's observing.
A lively squirrel, yeah. And if I can, and I want to add a couple more things from this period. And,
oh, yeah.
And you mentioned emblems. There's a very nice medal. This is a contemporary of the Hoffman. This is Francesco de' Medici, the Grand Duke of Tuscany, you know, also in the 1570s or 80s. And he used that squirrel there as an emblem. It says, with a quote from Catullus, which is often used as an emblem, that amat victoria curam, victory loves care, preparation. So squirrels are thought to prepare for the winter moment. Mm. So he's taken that as his emblems, even.
It's a little bulbous.
It's not a great squirrel, I'd say. It's not a Hoffman quality squirrel, but at least it's there. It's a very big mammal.
A horizontal squirrel.
Yeah, yes, yeah. He's not eating, he's carrying a branch. I don't know the details. We'll have to work on that, Anne.
Yeah.
And also I found this. I know, Anne, you like Dutch. You're a great expert in Dutch thing. This is emblems again, but these are from a book called Emblemata Amatoria, which is love emblems by Peter Hooft, 1611 in Amsterdam. And that is a little Cupid, and the squirrel is on a wheel, like a hamster wheel, running. And the little poem in Latin says, like a caged squirrel, I turn the wheel and turn it again. A circle without end pushes me on, trapped. I am in love.
Oh, no.
This is our squirrel love poem, I thought. We'd end our
That's so wonderful.
That's brilliant.
Is it like a habit trail where he can go through that little house into the building or something? Is it like an outdoor experience?
That is a superb question. I do not have the answer to that. Anne should be able to work on that. This is your
I'll look into that for you, Beth.
Okay, there we go. We'll get that answer.
Like there's a little door there, but I can't tell if that's like a shadow or
a shadow.
I think that's a shadow, but there is a little house there. So I suppose he lived in there. I think he probably does and comes out onto the wheel to run around every now and then. But anyway, I think that's all we've got for today. I mean, we really should have part two. So let's give this some thought. But I wanted to thank you all. I mean, this has been so much fun.
It was really fun. I feel validated.
That is great. That is great. And that's what we're here for, Keishia. So. All right, well, enjoy Squirrel Appreciation Day on Thursday. And
thank you for the invitation, Jeffrey. This
of course, been fun. Of course.
Thank you, Jeffrey.
Better people, and you're all stars. So I will talk to you again soon, I hope.
Goodbye.